To perform a short field landing, you're also asking for maximum performance out of that aircraft. And on your private pilot check ride, you do have to perform a short field approach and landing, and you are supposed to simulate clearing a 50-foot obstacle. So how we're going to do this is your downwind and base are basically normal, meaning that on your downwind, you will still start configuring a beam the numbers and usually use about 10 degrees of flaps on your downwind. And then when you turn base, the Airplane Flying Handbook says that you may want to extend your downwind just a little bit more, and that gives you more time to set up for a nice stabilized approach on final. But it's really optional. And when you turn base, normally you would go ahead and put your 20 degrees of flaps in. And then as you turn final, on a normal landing, we don't configure full flaps until we're absolutely assured that the runway is made. But in the short field landing technique, we want to go full flaps as soon as you turn final. Oops. So we'll go full flaps as soon as we turn final, and then we're also going to pitch the aircraft for the approach speed specified in the short field landing procedure section in your POH. So once we're on final, we have full flaps. What the profile view would look like if we have, say, some kind of obstacle right here, a bunch of trees, and we're trying to land and stop quickly, is a normal landing would kind of have an approach path like this. But a short field landing, we actually have to come in a little bit steeper and still make our same landing spot. So what happens by you adding full flaps as soon as you turn final and pitching for that slower airspeed is the pitch of the aircraft is up just slightly more. And we're going to control the airplane the same way you do when you're practicing slow flight. Remember when you practice slow flight how our pitch controls our airspeed and your throttle raises and lowers you? That's the same method we're going to use to bring that airplane in very, very precisely. So if we start to get too low and you see that you're not going to clear the trees, then you should add more power in order to arrest or stop some of that descent rate. But if you're clearly too high, then you would just pull the throttle back and allow the airplane to increase its descent rate. Now, of course, when you adjust the throttle, you will have to, in turn, adjust your pitch a little bit to still maintain your same approach speed. So remember, the object is to land in a certain spot and stop the airplane using minimal amount of runway. And depending on how close your obstacle is to the runway, you could use two different methods to make your landing spot. If the obstacle or the trees were very close to the runway, then you're going to have to keep your higher glide path until the very, very end. And then once you're clear of the trees, you'd have to reduce the throttle to idle. In the meantime, pitch down to keep your speed. And let's say your approach speed was supposed to be 60. So you're holding 60 with power in this configuration, and then you've cleared the trees, so suddenly you release or reduce the throttle, you'd have to pitch the aircraft down to maintain 60 and then go into your round out and flare. Now, if there was a decent amount of space between your obstacle and the runway, then you could really choose a landing site. Like, let's say you really wanted to touch down here, but you could aim for here, for example. And if you aimed early, you would have time to round out and flare, considering a little bit of drift. But if the obstacle was very, very close to your runway, again, you would have to hold the power in there until you're clear of the obstacle, reduce the idle, pitch down, and then kind of round out and flare all one right after the other. Now, this may be a situation when you want to purposely round out a little bit prematurely and take your airspeed from, say, 60 for your approach down to 55 or even 50 just above the runway. So as you're coming down, you kind of purposely round out just a little bit early. And what this does is then it avoids you riding in ground effect. If you round out a little early and allow the airplane to settle down through ground effect, you'll use less runway. Now, I'm not saying round out really high really soon and let the plane smack down to the runway, but just a little bit earlier than you would normally, because a normal approach and landing, you kind of purposely get down in ground effect to allow the airplane to land at the slowest speed possible. But rounding out a little bit early and allowing the airplane to kind of drop right down through ground effect works pretty nicely. Now, once you touch down on the ground, there's three things that you want to do kind of all at the same time. One is retract the flaps, and two is apply heavy braking, and three is yoke aft. The reason that you want to retract the flaps is because flaps produce lift, and if we can reduce that lift, it puts more weight on our wheels and makes our brakes more effective. Now, when you're applying brakes, be very, very careful. The proper technique would be to apply some brake pressure until you feel that your brakes are working, and then you would apply more and more pressure until you can bring the airplane to a stop. But be careful, don't get too excited and stomp the brakes and skid the tires or, you know, squeal down the runway. The reason that we're pulling the yoke to the aft position is two reasons. One, because when you apply firm braking, the weight comes forward on the nose wheel, and we don't want that. Remember, your nose wheel is very fragile. So we want to protect the nose wheel, but also because the yoke aft provides aerodynamic braking, where your wings are into the wind, and it'll help with aerodynamic braking. So a short field landing, your downwind and base are pretty much normal. As soon as you turn final, configure the airplane into full flaps and pitch for the approach speed specified in your POH. And then maintain that speed while you're on final. And you may choose to round out a little early, allow the airplane to kind of settle down through ground effect. And then once you've landed, you flaps up, heavy braking, and yoke back. Now the same thing for gusty conditions and our approach is also pertains to our landing. So if the winds were strong, in this scenario we were landing on runway 9, so let's say that the winds were out of 070 at 12 gusting to 20. So again, our gust factor would be 8, so we would add plus 4 to this number to keep a safe speed while we're approaching in there. So don't forget to add half your gust factor. Also, on your landing, don't forget your crosswind technique. If the winds were, in this example, out of the left, then we would have to land with the ailerons into the wind and a little bit of right rudder to maintain our center line and longitudinal axis in the direction of motion.